following interview was conducted with Margery Ismail for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Wednesday, August the 22nd, 2007, at a residence in West Lafayette. Welcome. This is part two.
I think that light.
Following up a little bit, we want to talk, backing a little bit, when the foreign student advisor, Titchener, was kind of the early one, so the pre before you became, and it became International Student Services, in 82, and you became the director.
Okay, well, he was the foreign student advisor when we came to Purdue, and it was he that we helped go through to get our immigration status from student to, in my husband's case, faculty. Taken care of. I didn't have a lot of connection with the office other than the official one. He had a rather small staff, I think, too. When I took over, there were only three other people in the office. So he handled pretty much the things that I did. But of course, our numbers were much smaller. There were about 1,200 students, and international students when I took over. And most of them were graduate students.
When did the influx, when did it begin, undergrad? Is it during your time, or did it begin before
then? Well, our numbers increased. When I retired, it was about 2,600 international students. A lot of that was at the graduate level. We did increase the number of undergrads, but Purdue did not, as a policy, recruit either in arts, on Titchener's day, or mine. We did a little indirect recruiting by getting alumni to staff a booth at international fairs in Hong Kong, for example, and once I happened to be in London when there was a big fair, big university fair going on there, and so I had a booth there, but there was no money for it, and just didn't do that. And it wasn't until after I left that the head of admissions, Doug Christensen, and the Times took from talking to him that President Baring and he and the then dean of international programs and Michael Dole got together, and the decision was made that they wanted to go out and actively recruit. And of course now we've got around 5,000, and the big increase has been in the international level. But we did not have a huge number of international graduate students. Undergraduate students.
You said you did some contacts in Hong Kong. Perhaps was the Alumni Association some help?
It was the Alumni Association did it for us. I've made a connection. I wanted to find an alum, and the alumni office just gave me the list, and I rather picked him out at random. It turned out we had a close mutual friend, so I picked well. Lucky, I guess. And I spent a very nice day with them when I was in Hong Kong in 1980. I suppose it was, yes, 1985, and explained to him that I had no money in my budget for recruiting, but that we got very good students from Hong Kong and we'd like some help from them. And he agreed. He would organize it. He'd put it young people. He was a very successful businessman with a PhD in pharmacy from Purdue, and he did. And it was extremely successful, so much so that Professor Hath, who later became the provost, well, was the provost then, I think, said to me one day, "Where are you getting these super students from Hong Kong from? They're just great. I've got several in my class. They're wonderful." So I told him that we'd actually done a little indirect recruiting.
Mm-hmm.
He said, "Well, it worked." But we really were not in the business of undergraduate education for international students in any big way. There was no financial help whatsoever. Well, almost none. It was a loan program. And we had a scholarship, a very small scholarship program for students who encountered financial difficulties after they started in their program. And I had a little committee that used to made up of academic advisors, academic in the department. And we would select or we would review the students who applied for it. But it wasn't anything given to incoming students. It wasn't advertised. It was more of a student who'd lost a parent or revolution in the country or, you know, all the things that would
disrupt.
Yes, and it was a fee remission that paid fees.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That was quite small. There were 50 spots.
Do the students have to come with their, be able to pay their way pretty much? Were many of them sponsored by the government or family?
Yes, we had programs, different government programs. Kitchener, I think, and they sort of began to run out. We have one with Nigeria, which really collapsed when the trouble in Nigeria and the change in government, and we lost that. Many of the students were in bad straits for a while. The numbers weren't huge, though. Mm-hmm. And then later, after I was in the office, we were part of MUCA, Midwestern University Consortium for International Affairs, I guess. And this was a joint...
The university was a member?
Of MUCA, yeah. It was a consortium. And we were part of a program to bring in engineering students, and they did 2 years at campus in Malaysia, where the Big Ten and the other members of MUCA, mostly Big Ten schools, provided the faculty. And they did that for 2 years, and they needed more English. They got that, and these were all native Malay, and some of them didn't. Quite a lot of women came through on that program, and they were skillful negotiators. There on an occasion where we were negotiating what we needed for them to transfer in, and they wanted a lot more credit than we were prepared to give. But eventually it all worked out, and we did get numbers of those students. I don't know if that program's still going, but it was very successful. They were good students and graduated.
Did most of them go back to their home country?
Well, in that case, they had to. I should explain something about the visa regulation.
Good.
There are two kinds of student visas. There's an F visa, which is for a student who's probably privately funded. It's a straightforward student visa. And in order to get a student visa from my husband, came on and I came as his dependent. And to do that, you have to show that you have enough money in the bank. You have to actually, in our case, we had to actually deposit it with the American Embassy to keep us for a year. And they sent it to us, we doled that monthly through the Egyptian consulate, actually. So we got our allowance our first year. So you cannot get a visa, you can't even apply for a visa until you've shown evidence that you do have the resources. And we were graduate students, of course. And in our case, my husband had a free admission scholarship, so we just had to show that we had resources to pay our way, so to speak. But of course, it's gone up tremendously. We were asking, I think, for 12 months support and fees for 2 semesters, and then I believe when I left, it was in the region of 15,000, probably 10,000 when I started, I think, and courses continue to rise because they pay overstate fees. And until they can show they have that, they aren't going to get the visa. So that's privately funded, or if they are being funded by an organization, frequently the organization is a family who just decides they'll all get together and send this worthwhile young person to school in the States. And then there are the ones sponsored by their government or by our government. But the numbers coming with American sponsorship is quite small. It's mostly sponsorship from either a government or a company. In the case of Japan, it's often a company. And this is both graduate and undergraduate. And they come on what's called the J visa, which is an exchange visa. And a requirement of that visa is that they return for 2 years to work in their home country. Fulbrights come under that, for example. Anybody coming on the Fulbright award has to go home for 2 years. Yeah.
Okay.
So that would be a typical example of the kind of award. So quite a lot of our students. And that program, in my day, was administered by the U.S. Information Agency, which is now that was an independent body. That has now been incorporated back into the State Department, where it was years ago. And so they still administer that, but they're through the State Department these days. And it's quite hard, quite difficult to get around that. Only if there were a real problem, maybe because of a revolution or war in the country, or some circumstance that would make it dangerous for the students to go back. Is that ever waived? And we sometimes had to work on the waivers for people that the university wanted to hire.
little bit about your work, your contacts with immigration and local and state, or
the State Department issues visas. So the first step is to get a visa. And the school, the university, whatever entity, issues the document that lays out exactly what the student will be getting from the school, if anything, and that they have been admitted. And if it's an S visa, it's called an I-20 form, and if it's a J visa, it's an I-T-66. And they go armed with that and with whatever financial evidence they have to show, either that they have support from somewhere on an I-T-66 or J-1, or that they have funding in the bank. I mean, they have to have evidence that they've got the money. Can't just go and say, yes, my father will pay for me. And they do that before they get the visa. The visa admits them to enter the country. When they enter the country, there is a little document, a little paper, kept in the passport called an I-94. The I-94 is the Immigration Service's notification to them that you've been admitted for this long. So from then on, it doesn't really matter what the visa says, it's what the I-94 says, because that's immigration, is how long they've given them to stay. And if they go home anytime, they have to get a new I-20 and a new date on when they're going to finish the program. So normally they'll be given, they anticipate 4 years for an undergraduate degree. They will extend it. Usually it's not hard to get an extension. And anything up to 7 years, of course, if it's graduate work, but they don't usually give 7 years. They will give a certain period of time. The problem for the student is their visa may have expired. And if they go home and their visa's expired, because they're given for varying lengths of time, too. On the visa. Then they've got to go through the whole business of getting permission to come back into the country again. And students do sometimes get stuck. And so the faculty, not realizing or deciding they'll risk it and then they can't get back in because their visa's no longer current. It doesn't matter as long as they stay in the country if their I-94 is up to date. And that we would remind them, if it's expiring, come to us for the renewal. That's then done by immigration, provided they stay within the U.S. So it's a bit complicated. There are two different
forms that have to be kept.
Entities there. And the visa can expire. That's okay, as long as you don't leave the country. And that means don't go up to Canada. And we warn them time and time again, don't go to Canada, don't go to Mexico if you're going to get a six-month visa and it's expired, because you won't be able to get back in. And they get tired of students going doing that, and you may find yourself on a plane back to
wherever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, it's a very convoluted process, actually.
Wasn't there, after 9/11, there was quite a drop, was there a drop in applications?
Well, because the embassies and the consulates all over, the American U.S. consulates started scrutinizing the visas much more carefully, and I think they're fingerprinting or they're doing some kind of other means of identity. The issuance of visa all over has been greatly tightened up.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So,
not as easy as
no,
it used to be.
No. I think it's relaxed a little bit. I think it's a little easier because the waits were so long, I simply didn't have the staff to process with additional scrutiny all the applications that we're getting.
Did many of the students like to bring, were they able to bring their families, or how did that?
If they had the financial support, there again, you had to show you had, it had to be enough for both of us when we came, had to be enough to support me. Because student spouses are not allowed to work, at least on an F student visa, the spouse cannot work. An exchange student is a J-1, by a dependent, is a J-2. They can get permission, but it has to come from me
something. And then and you mentioned you were advising, not counseling.
Well, we did not have the staff. I mean, we didn't have qualified psychological counseling staff. And of course, first they got into some kind of problem on campus, then they would go to the dean of students usually. And we worked with the dean of students back and forth pretty carefully. Students who got dropped, we always worked together with the dean of students on getting them readmitted and where we could send them and so on. And we succeeded in getting a number of dropped students down to very close to zero. We worked very hard at that. We tightened up our admission requirements too. And that was just internal to the office. So we became a little more selective, I would say, in my day. And I'm sure that's continued. Because you don't want people to come over here and not succeed. You don't admit people to fail, in other words. Especially
too much
far from home. And yeah. So things like that we worked with. But no, we weren't a counseling office. Not that we didn't have students come to us with financial problems, and probably the area where we did most, I guess you'd call it counseling help, was in the financial area, working with the bursar to defer fee payments and so on. That was quite time consuming. I look back and think about it. We spent quite a bit of time on that.
And the cost of living and getting adjusted to all of that.
Yeah.
Well,
yes, we were always available if students had a problem, but mostly what we would do if it was a problem that they were really struggling in their classes, we would refer them to their academic counselor. We'd talk to the academic counselor, don't we? We sort of fluffed them off, but we didn't have the ability to do, except to the ones who didn't have a major. And then we did counsel them until they developed.
What did you do with the ones that didn't have a major? What sort of role did you play in that?
Well, the admissions person.
I thought you'd have to have some idea
yes.
when you came what you might want to major in.
Yes. Well, they don't always know. Or what they think they want to do, they haven't been admitted to, and so they've accepted something else, or they won't want to accept anything else, so they'll come in as uncommitted. Just to make sure they get courses to get into a program that's a viable program. And just about any academic counselor would do, really.
Mm-hmm.
And the person who did that was the admissions person, the undergraduate admissions.
Is there a time limit on do they have to declare a major within 1 or 2 years?
No,
or?
I think they don't. Well, they may do now, but they didn't then. But you try and get them into a major as soon as possible, of course. But sometimes they aren't happy and they change majors. And
it's called CODO.
They can't CODO unless if they're sponsored by their government or by some entity, they go study. But of course, students who came privately could, but the parents often didn't want them to, and so we did a certain amount of hand-holding over that sometimes. Like the electrical engineering student who wanted to study music is the one I remember, and it just happened I knew his uncle, but met his parents. They were very upset. He did eventually go somewhere else and study music. But they know often the major's been decided by the family, or they've accepted to do a major because that's a way of getting here. That's not what they want to do at all.
It might be the family business, too.
Oh, to go in the family business, yes.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Oh, yes, they're filling a niche, you know, so they've got to study, and if they can't get into, let's say, electrical engineering. And we had a case like that. Woo! We had calls from the governor and Mexican faculty happened to be a very powerful. All his six, they had 7 boys, and the other 6 had all been to Purdue and graduated from Purdue. And by golly, number 7 was coming here too.
Whether he wanted it or not.
Oh, well, he was a spoiled baby, you know. I remember Art didn't give me a lot of advice, but that was one bit he gave me. He said, "Watch out for that youngest child of the family with a long Purdue tradition. They think it's going to be just a walkover, and they're a bit
It'll
shocked
be a breeze.
When they get here and find it's not, that's right, not the breeze they thought it was going to be."
Sure.
And I didn't need experience that. I thought of him.
Yeah. And, of course, you had some help. Your staff expanded quite a bit when you got in.
Yes, we didn't have an admissions person when I went in there. And I thought we needed to be doing a much more detailed review of the undergraduate applications. And I became very active both in NAFSA, the Association of International Educators, which is sort of our profession. consistency and make sure we were pretty much in line with what other schools were doing. I think all universities went through that sort of change from it being a one-person operation like it really was for our kitchen when he started to being a professional office.
Right.
I think it started a bit in his time, but I didn't have the experience. I had to go to the literature and just learn. I knew for the British system, but I didn't know much for any other system, so you just have to learn about the different systems. And until we got the missions officer, I did those. They, it wasn't a huge number. We got a lot of applications, but I don't have figures at my fingertips, but we did receive quite a lot.
Did you have any contact with the other officers on the Big Ten campus?
Oh, sure. We, yes.
You had exchange?
Well, the CIC. City on Institution Cooperation, is that what it is? Anyway, it's Big Ten plus the University of Chicago. Yes, the director.
Very big operation these days.
The director, well, it was then the directors of International Student Services, like all other entities, met once a year. And we also, the NAFSA organization had regional meetings. And so we went to the national meeting always of both NAFSA and ACRO, and we went to the regional meeting where we became quite active. And I always went to the CIC meeting, and then MUSEA developed, and so that was another meeting we went to once a year. So there was a lot of, interaction. And then one gets to know one's fellow directors and the people in the office. And we also had, I, for example, went down to the American Immigration Lawyers meetings in Chicago. They were interested in international ALO. What that acronym stood for. Now, they were kind enough to invite me to their meetings, and that was a good exchange because I had a
very
slightly
helpful.
Different. I handled things differently from the way they did. Of course, they were handling people coming for work. They're very, very helpful if you really.
It's another contact
learn
too.
From each other. Yeah,
right.
And there were some lawyers in Chicago who would have a good workshop once a year. We always went to those,
mm-hmm.
And a couple of us, and Northwestern always have good. Once a year, where we met with we come under the Chicago region for immigration. So the director of the immigration office in Chicago was for this whole Midwest region. The second year I had the job, we had a drive-in workshop here at Purdue. This was advice from a colleague to do this early in my career. And we invited the director from Chicago, so I got to know him. And from then on in, he just called me one day and said, I'd like to come down and visit your campus and bring my wife. So we developed a very close working relationship with him and his staff. And it paid off, because when we had a real problem, I didn't go to him very often, but if we needed to, we could. And he was always very helpful. He was a very good officer, I thought.
Good.
And then here locally, the local office was limited in what it could do, but if we had a student who had forgotten, for example, that his I-94 was going to run out, they would help us expedite that. There is such a volume of paperwork in immigration, and I think they're more computerized. They hadn't even begun then. We produced our documents, on the computer, but everything had to be handled, and they used to send a lot of the university student stuff up to the Alcan border because the agents out there aren't very busy, especially in the winter. They may not even get one car a day, and so they would work on them. Well, this is where going to meetings pays off, because learned about this and even learned who the agents up there were, and so we could call them. Had a desperate situation. He didn't abuse it, but more than once was told that Alcan border, and so staff members said, would you like to dig through your papers and find this one, because it's about to expire, and the students are the sick, so we gotta go home. And they were funny. They quite enjoyed it. Sometimes they said, yeah, first person I talked to today, it'll be 3 p.m. So,
yeah, it's a crisis situation, though.
It's interesting. I learned a lot about the way that all works.
What about your contacts with the other state? What about regional campuses? Was there much international students?
We were responsible for the regional campus. they said, well, it would have to be these ranks. And we said, wait a minute. We're going to be put in with all the schools in Indiana. IU has a medical school. The staff at the medical faculty, you're going to skew those. And it did. First year, we said, no way. We can't possibly match mine in engineering. Can we match those salaries? So then they said, okay, by discipline at your institution. So we had to put that together every year for what the, high balloon mean, I think, for each
all kinds of calculations.
Including all the research positions, senior research assistant, junior research assistant, so on. Anything where we might likely to be hiring somebody who is not a U.S.
What about contacts with the other state universities? Any contact, was there any contacts you ever get together with any of them? Or?
Well, that was CIC.
Oh, so you'd come through there.
We visited back and forth.
I mean, in states within Indiana.
That was, yeah. Well, within Indiana, there is actually a little organization within the NAFSA organization that is the state representative, but mostly that was confined to our region, which is Kentucky, Ohio, three or four of us. I think Pennsylvania was in our region. But that was within the region. Within the state, of course, we all know each other. And we all gave workshops at one time or another. I mean, I gave that one that was just on immigration. We gave that one. And then, another school.
So there's good camaraderie.
We've got the director from Chicago coming, and we're going to put on the drive-in workshops, we call them, so we go for a day.
Sounds good.
And there are all kinds of other little things that would come up where somebody get a bit of money to do something, and they put on a symposium or something.
A program.
A lot of formal stuff through the organizations and informal stuff more done by the schools. Yeah. Oh, yeah, we talk to each other a lot, too.
That's very helpful. Yeah. And then you served under, when you were, Dr. Hubby was just, no,
he
John
had,
Hicks?
No, he stepped down. It was John Hicks.
Hicks when he came on.
A new President Hubby, of course, and it's on a personal note. I got a phone call one day about a young man coming from Kuwait, and it was a request from his son to see if we could take a special look at this young man's application, somebody they were doing business with. So we did, of course, and I called him and told him what. I don't think we could admit him to the program we wanted, but we did admit him, and he did get a degree from this. And when we finished that conversation, Dr. Henry said to me, are you Professor Ismail's wife? And I said, yes. He said, well, I thought that was you. And he said, I want an excellent appointment. He was a sweetheart. Well,
yeah.
And then, of course, Dr. Hanton.
Yeah, Dr.
Yeah.
And then, of course,
no, Dr.
Baring came, right. And then, you were here when, you know, you retired when Dr. Baring was still here.
Yeah, because Hanton came between Dr. Hefty. So Dr. Hefty's been gone for a while, but yeah, I remember him calling me. I've been in the office long. And then Dr. Baring.
Right. And now, what when you changed from student services to international programs, what was the impact on that?
Well, initially, not very much. That was sort of a kind of period of, from, I still
often that occurs.
Yeah, because they didn't really know, you know, it had all been hidden under the Hospital Student Services. So, yes, I think that then enabled them to enlarge and, of course, to increase the number of undergrad students when they decided to do that. I don't know what size of staff is now. It was 22, I think, a short while ago. And I had professional staff. See, I had 4, 5, maybe, when I left, plus clerical, plus work study, 11 altogether.
That's
a lot, yeah. So 22 include clerical.
Yeah. They have students do work study students.
Oh, I'm sure they do. We use work study students to open mail and sort mail and send out mailings because
and
we get a lot of applications and we have
a lot of paper.
A lot of paper, and that still goes on. I think more goes on by email now than it did in my day. I mean, we had the email, of course, before I retired, but
much more heavier now, as you well know.
Yeah.
And you talked about, you took some tours, didn't you, while you were around? You were going to make a comment about that. You visited some countries in conjunction with your, when you were in student services, or was it afterwards?
No, I did quite a few that were work-related, yeah.
Any particular one sticks in your mind? Or?
Well, I think I mentioned before that I went to Taiwan, and that was an invitation to directors of offices as a sort of thank you. And that wasn't really exactly hard work. It was hectic. They took us around, and we went to a lot of different schools. Purdue was very big in Taiwan, so I had a very good reception there.
Sure.
And they've been doing it for a while, and they had a program laid out. You went to the ministry, and saw all the appropriate people. And you asked any questions, and they asked a lot of questions, but we didn't have a great deal of contact with students. It was mostly with administrators high up. We usually met the president of the university, and it was interesting. It was certainly interesting for somebody who had just come on the job, because that came within my first year. Then mainland China, People's Republic, who had not done that before, invited a group in 1985. And because we had one of the larger numbers of Chinese students and scholars, which Johnson and Purdue both had.
At that time?
Yes, we had 100, I think, Pacific scholars, and then we'd begun to take students by 1985, and that was the first group that went. And so, Wisconsin and MIT and UCLA, Stanford, Texas A&M, I think, Michigan State, UCLA, and now trying to remember all the schools that went, there were 10 of them. And that was sort of exploratory because they hadn't done it before and they weren't quite so organized as Taiwan was, but we did go to Beijing and Xi'an and Hangzhou and Suzhou was just to visit, and Guangzhou. I used to visit at the time. Shanghai. Yes, we visited to those cities and the major universities there.
Get to interact with students? Do you interact with some students?
Not until the very end. They hadn't sort of quite got that idea that maybe we would like to see students. And I think maybe our leader, who was the director from MIT and the eldest of the group, everything went by seniority, by age. Yes, seniority by age, not by school necessarily. I think he may have mentioned it to them that it would be good to meet with more students. And so in Guangzhou, we did. That was interesting. And I said, they had the students who had applied to our schools just meet with us independently. And so I said, break-in period, we've mm-hmm. taken students, but we had a lot of working out details for them, and that was very interesting. Quite enjoyed that. And we got to see the campus, of course. You always get nicely entertained when you go to these places. And on my own, on that same trip, I visited Indonesia, where we had a much smaller program and not as well developed as Malaysia. I didn't find the person there quite knew what he was doing. But I did visit Indonesia. And then I went on the Fulbright to Germany. I think I mentioned that before. And that was also, schools had largely taken students from Germany, and we were part of an exchange arrangement that went on there. So that was always appreciated. That was competitive. You applied for that. And I was encouraged to do that. And I'm glad I did. We met students everywhere. We met in Germany.
The alumni from what you say, particularly in your smaller countries, would be a good contact.
Yes, I also was the Purdue host for two alumni trips, one to Kenya and one to Israel. And there, of course, the Alumni Association wants you to have a meeting, and so in both places we did, and invited any local alums to come. It's interesting. Enjoyed that.
Well,
it's nice to keep in touch because, like the situation in Hong Kong, you never know when you might want contact.
Exactly. When you look back on any particular thing that kind of sticks in your mind as a highlight of your international students or when you were in there?
So many.
Anyone that...
That was a very busy
made it
period of my life. Well, I really enjoyed getting to know the students. And many of them, as I say, we were in the advising office, we were the first place they stopped, but if they were in any sort of problems with anything, well, we did see them, and I did see all of them, of course, as people saw some, but I enjoyed hearing that. Did I tell you the story of the cricket score? It's always sticks in my mind because students from Nigeria, I still remember his name, and I told this story just this summer to a student from Nigeria who was the African student put on the dinner at the International Center, and he said, "What did you say his name was?" So I said, "Samuel Akinbami." He said, "He was one of my professors." So that's a nice Purdue story for you. But Sam was a graduate student, and somehow at some function or other we got to talking cricket. Of course, they play cricket in Nigeria, and he found out I was interested. And so one day he said to me, "There's a test match. There was a test match going on, and I can't remember if it was England or South Africa, I think something like that." So he would come by the office, and I didn't have a long shortwave radio. He did. And he'd come by the office and say, "Very urgent, I must see Mrs. Ismail immediately." And they'd say, "Well, busy. Well, would you call her and see if she could see me for a minute?" And of course, I'd always say yes, and Sam would stick his head around the door and give me the score. And this went on for quite a while. Whenever there's a test match, and they go on for quite a while, several days. And they said, "Why is it with Sam?" And I laughed. I said, "Well, he has to come and tell me what score is on the cricket match."
Yeah,
it doesn't stay very long. It just means that there's somebody there. They say, "What's all that about?" And they say, "Well, that's the test match score." It's as much as big a thing or bigger because it involves so many countries. The baseball here would be.
Oh, yeah, right.
I always love it. I always think of Sam very fondly, and I'm glad to know he's a successful professor back home.
It's nice to know those kinds of things. Yeah,
it is.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, Chauncey Village has changed a lot, hasn't it, since you've been here?
Well, yes, it has. Of course, it was much more of a community center when we first came here.
In what sense? What would you mean?
Well, I mean, there were a variety of stores, of course. There was a laundromat and a dry cleaner, but there were all the Dillon's, the hardware store on the corner, and there were several clothing stores. And
more retail. There was more retail.
Oh, yeah. It was a real little retail center. And the only place that served alcoholic beverages was Harry's, of course. There weren't all the bars. And the restaurant Peking, I think that opened up to Peking, but quite early. And Fackworth, of course, was there. But it was very different. It was much, much more of a community center. Morton was still a school. When we first came, the library was still in that little old building that's still closer, yeah, and because I commuted to Kokomo at least twice a week or more, and it was difficult to do carpool.
Sure.
Yeah.
Anything that I didn't ask that you'd like to, did I miss anything?
Well, yeah, a couple of things that I might mention. I was thinking about, you can probably tell, I have a very international sort of perspective on the world, and I think that all started from high school, when I was, my last 2 years in high school in England, it's called sixth form, it's a 2 year junior and senior year, and you're doing a, you're working towards getting a, well, it's not called A-level, but it's called higher certificate of education in my day, which you don't need it to go to university, you do matriculation at 16, but you, you really do need it, they expect you to have taken it before you go to university. And we were encouraged by our staff to go to the annual meeting of the Council for Education and World Citizenship, which met in London. And the war was still on, of course. The first year I went would have been 43, and then I went again in 44. I graduated in the summer from high school, summer of 45. And it was absolutely eye-opener to me, a country girl from a village, you know, going to a small high school in a small market town. They had outstanding speakers, and the idea was to educate young people in the thought